Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Handbook for Bad Days, Shortcuts to Get Present When Things Aren't Perfect by Eveline Helmink. Translated by Victor Verbeek and Marlene Raymer. Read by Catherine Ho. For you. Because at night I heard you crying and I didn't know quite what to say. I found some words. Sharing our hurt is sharing our humanity. Author's note. This is not your average self-help book. I don't propose a method or a ready-to-use five-step plan for your hard days. Sometimes all a bad day needs is a fluffy cardigan, a hot shower, or a nice walk. Sometimes you can keep it simple. Other times you need a little more. The shortcuts in this book are designed to make it easier for you to get started. I am not a coach, a psychologist, or a teacher, but I've had a lifelong fascination with frayed edges, imperfection, and resilience. These days, I consider myself a cheerleader for adversity, chagrin, and discomfort, and it's my experience that although bad days don't exactly make life pleasant, they do make it interesting. They are part of life, neither good nor bad on their own. And it's often on the days when things aren't going so well that you'll learn the most about yourself. As Pema Chodron says, we think that the point is to pass the test or to overcome the problem, but the truth is that things don't really get solved. The healing comes from letting there be room for all of this to happen, room for grief, for relief, for misery, for joy. I hope with all my heart that the Handbook for Bad Days will help you to face your worst days with courage, with compassion, and with your head held high. Eveline Helmink. Introduction. I take the key from the ignition of my car and watch as the rain hits my windshield. In 5 minutes, at 3:30, I will be with my mother, which gives me 5 more minutes inside this steel cocoon. I already know what's about to unfold. I've had this experience many times before. First, a feeling of resistance boils up inside of me. I don't want to. I don't want this. I want my mother to be healthy and living at home with my father. This is unfair and stupid. Then sadness washes over me. I don't want things to change or pass, and I want my mother back, and I want it now. Then comes the bargaining. She is still there, and she may no longer speak the language of words, but the language of love, which is universal and timeless. Then the fear. What if she's sad? What if she's not having a good day? Then the courage. I'll be there. Followed by acceptance. This is how it is. I observe all of it and exhale. Only then do I open the door and get out. My arms spread wide. I smile a real smile. And then I go and see my mother. In a time when we are so eager to share how perfectly our lives are going, how hashtag blessed we are, and what a great job we're doing to get the most out of our body, mind, and soul at every moment, there doesn't seem to be much room for the inexorable truth that in every human life, there are days that are, well, bad. Days when there seems to be less of everything, less energy, less flow, and less positivity. Days when everything seems to go wrong. When, for example, you are all but certain you will end up lonely and miserable, simply because it's your destiny, and after all signs are pointing to the inevitable. Why else would you have a flat tire? Or days when, even though nothing extraordinary is happening, you wake up with a knot in your stomach, and a faint mist of sadness is hanging around you, and whatever you do, you cannot seem to shed it. Your skin is breaking out, your hair is lifeless, and you meditate for an hour because it's supposed to help. But then you drop your bowl of yogurt and granola on the kitchen floor and conclude, I might as well have stayed in bed. No matter how thoroughly you search, you can't find your mojo anywhere. Sometimes bad days happen in reaction to things that are unfair, unexpected, or embarrassing. Your boss gives you some unwelcome feedback, or you're going through a rough patch with your partner. Other times, they appear out of the blue. It hurts, having a day when you wish you could give the finger to the merciless universe that seems to conspire against you, and it feels as if the universe, in total indifference to the fate of one of its billions of earth-dwelling inhabitants, is returning the gesture. It's paradoxical, but on tough days, everything feels both incredibly personal and totally impersonal at the same time. Now, I don't know about you, but the moments when I'm grumpy, irritated, sad, and/or tired are not the moments when I want to hear that I should meditate more. I don't necessarily feel like braving a rainstorm to bike to the gym, or spending an hour in the kitchen to make a plant-based meal, or motivating myself to scrutinize a thick and complicated self-improvement book, however healing those things may be. On my bad days, I lack the energy. I want nothing. When you're having a hard day, hearing about all the things you should be doing is usually not what you are hoping for. Just like you'd prefer that no one tell you that you will find another in no time after your boyfriend just walked out the door, or that there will be better opportunities after you've missed out on another job. It's not that these pieces of advice aren't meaningful. They often make all the sense in the world. But while you may know there's wisdom there, that's not what it feels like. On hard days, it takes just a little bit longer to get from zero to zen than on days when everything is rolling along smoothly. To put it plainly, on my worst days, I'm pretty pleased with myself if, by the end of the day, I've managed to wash my hair and not polish off the entire pint of ice cream in one sitting. As you can probably tell by now, I have a lot of experience with bad days. But, of course, the great irony is that I am an editor-in-chief for one of the biggest happiness brands in one of the happiest countries on earth, the Netherlands. My magazine, Happinez, is committed to happiness, personal growth, and meaningful and purposeful living. We produce magazines all over the world, provide online courses, and organize and host dozens of events each year, including a 3-day happiness festival. In recent years, Happinez has inspired hundreds of thousands, if not millions of people worldwide, by sharing our views on happiness and what it means to live a mindful life. As a matter of fact, not a day goes by that I don't concern myself with these topics. I can safely say I am all about happiness. Not only did I turn it into my job, even after office hours, I always have happiness on my mind. Just like everyone else, I too like to live a pleasant, light, and effortless life. So why, you might be asking, is this woman whose personal and professional life is all about happiness writing a book about bad days? Why would someone like that be cheerleading for sitting with our disappointment, headwinds, and overall misery? Because if there's one thing I know after a lifetime of thinking about happiness, it's that happiness is not like completing a marathon, where you cross the finish line, are awarded a medal, and remain eternally gratified. That's just not how happiness works. Happiness isn't a constant state of being. It isn't static, solid, and permanent. On the contrary, happiness is dynamic, flowing, and free. True happiness isn't about cutting out the bad days. It's about accepting life as it is. And in fact, it's often on those days when everything falls apart that we learn the most about what brings us comfort, resilience, courage, strength, and yes, happiness. However much we'd like to hold on to it forever, happiness comes and happiness goes. I sometimes compare happiness to a wild animal. You can't catch it, can't hold it in a cage, and you can't tame it. Happiness has to be free in order to be authentic. In a world in which, theoretically, we can have anything we want, it can chafe that happiness is not something we can possess. Slowly but surely, the idea has permeated our society that happiness can be engineered and that, As long as you work hard enough, all your dreams will come true. Every TV commercial, talent show, and social media post is aimed at making us believe that.
You are the creator of your happiness,
and if you aren't happy, it is your own fault. So we pursue happiness. We search for it everywhere. We build halls of mirrors of perfection, joy, and control, only to be shocked by any blemishes, cracks, and dents. We tell ourselves that life should never be ugly or uncomfortable. Any pain or failure is to be polished away, repaired, reversed, or at least swept under the rug as quickly as possible.
You would almost feel guilty for having bad days.
Oh, you feel miserable? Such a shame you haven't managed to meditate that out of your system yet. I find that attitude so unnecessary. A life spent thinking in binary qualifications, happy and unhappy, perfect and imperfect, beautiful and ugly, can never be a complete one. Disappointments, discomfort, resistance, pain, and misery are part of life, too. They're intrinsic to being human. Only after you've learned to accept the dark alongside the light can you really say that you're living your life to the fullest. Bad days are included. I call a life in which you are prepared to also accept lesser days and in which you dare to feel both good and bad, an inclusive life. You can only experience deep inner peace if you give up your forced attempts to become the best version of yourself and instead aspire to be the purest, most authentic version of yourself, flaws included. In his bestseller, The Subtle Art of Not Giving a Fuck, Mark Manson very clearly explains why the pursuit of happiness can be so contradictory. He says, and pay attention, because it really is a bit of a mindfuck, the longing for a positive experience is in essence a negative.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.